really, you know, one of the essence of third space is it's about interaction and co-creation and empathy and things like that. So I, with your permission, what I want to do is really engage in a dialogue, a discussion. And so what I will do is lay out the basics of third space thinking and maybe a little bit about why we decided to pursue it. And then I'm going to shut up and ask a question or two, and then I'm going to ask you guys to answer, you know, to talk about third space. Is that pretty clear? Okay. So I'm going to ask you questions like, what do you think is the most valuable of the five attributes that you've looked at? What, you know, in your life, what do you think has been most valuable? Do you think that those are attributes that you can use to communicate effectively with others? For example, some folks have said, we like this because this will help those of us as millennials talk to the boomers, which is a polite term for people like me who are old. So it'll be a way for the millennials to talk to the boomers. And how many of you have had jobs how many of you have worked? Okay, good, a substantial number. So one of the things I want to get from you is what do you think would be most helpful about this third space approach in your job life, whether you're doing it now or whether you've done it in the past. So this is going to be interactive. It will be me talking a little bit, but I hope you talking more. So we'd like to get your feedback. And my brother here on the camera will be recording it.
So are we there?
Okay, well, I'm going to show you one of the things I'm most proud of. You all are too young to remember this, but in the pre-digital era, there used to be something called postcards. And postcards were ways to convey information and communication. So this is a postcard. I don't know if you've seen the, I'm going to maybe give one per row. Oh, you know what a postcard is. Oh, you'll pass it. Okay. Thanks. And so when we go around, well, let me back up a little bit. So here's the first thing I want to say is, why did the Annenberg team go out and do research on this third space stuff? Okay. And I know in this class there's a lot of emphasis on research and measuring things. And I know sometimes you probably say, I wish they would stop talking about concepts and measuring and all this stuff. But it can be helpful. So about 4 years ago, as dean and talking to my immediate advisors, the question was, what should we be teaching in comm management? What should we be teaching undergraduates? What should we be teaching in public relations? And so we thought about it. And what's the best way to get an answer to that? Is it to have five professors sit in a room and decide what we should teach? What's your name?
Me.
Yes.
Rukin.
Rukin?
I think you should probably gather like several students and talk about what you guys want to learn.
Okay.
And then you can maybe talk to the professionals in this industry.
Right.
And let them decide what they want to get.
Hey, did you get that? Great. You get an A for the class. And that's absolutely right, that we talk to the students, but, you know, with all due respect, students, okay. Who we really talk to were the people who employ our students, who employ our graduates. And we said, when you hire people, what skills are you looking for? And they said, we know we need MBAs. We know we need engineers. Any engineers in the room? Any engineering students? Good, so I can say bad things about engineers. Engineers are great, but they tend to be kind of linear in the way they think. And it's like, okay, this way, boom. And what we heard from people at Google and Microsoft and Amgen and American Express and Ford Motor Company and Walt Disney and Entertainment Arts and the World Bank and the Communist Chinese Communist Party. They said, we want students who have a multiple set of skills. It's nice if they can know some mathematics, a little bit of engineering, but there's a set of skills that we really need them to have. And they said, Dean Wilson, if you can produce students who have those five attributes that we talk about, we will hire all of them at 9 o'clock on Monday morning. That's a pretty good deal. We teach you guys these skills. Now already, as you know, most of you will get jobs if you don't have them already. We have a placement rate at the Annenberg School for Communication and Journalism that is almost embarrassing. It's almost embarrassing because I say the numbers and even I don't believe the numbers. But my placement offices keep telling me it's true year after year. Class of 2014, 85% we've been able to identify, about 95% of the students get jobs 1 year after graduating. And 93% of those in fields where they want to be working. So it's not flipping burgers or working at IHOP, which isn't so bad. I got good food at IHOP, so it's not so bad. So the background to this is we wanted to figure out what to teach you so when you go out into the world, you can lead change, not just accept the change. Okay? And the way that we were told to do that is to come up with some soft skills. So we did. We identified those five. And I will quickly, very quickly, run through what these five are. And I want to say two things about them. But I'll start with, why don't I start with intellectual curiosity. All of us probably know people who are always asking questions. And sometimes they're a pain in the butt. Say, wait, stop with the question. Stop with the question. But they are intellectually curious. They want to get to the root explanation of things. And intellectual curiosity is probably essential in a world that is changing rapidly. Why would that be? Why would you need to be intellectually curious in a world that is changing rapidly? Now, by the way, this is a very interactive class. I will treat you better if you raise your hand really quickly. Otherwise, I will make you stand up and address the class. So work with me on this. I'll be nice at first, but you've really got to be interactive here. Because that's one of the things that they said. If you're not interactive, it's going to be tougher to get a job. You could be really smart. You can be really empathetic. But if you don't say anything, then your employers will not select you. They'll hire someone who is more interactive. So that's a real, and that those, oh, there, see, I said the right thing, and the lights come on.
I turned them off.
No, you didn't.
I lifted them up, and I turned them off.
Did you really?
I'm so sorry.
You confess. How empathetic.
And I'm here every Tuesday, Thursday, morning in this classroom.
That's funny.
I had no idea they're always on.
Yes. Yeah. So why would it be a good thing to be intellectually curious if the world is changing?
It is very important to be intellectually curious because it's very important not to stay stagnant. And I feel that if you stay stagnant, you're not really living. You're not living to your fullest, to the fullest, and to the fullest that you're capable of.
Right.
And I feel like the ultimate goal in life is to keep excelling and keep growing and learning more about yourself. And you don't want to get left behind
right.
when everyone, including technology and society, is
right.
speeding up and you're just staying still.
That's a great answer. That's really, do we get that? That's a really great answer. And how do you do that is you ask questions before other people ask them. I mean, this is where the competitive piece comes in. And part of what I want to do is equip you with the tools you need to be successful in the workplace. And intellectual curiosity is one of the starting points. You know who Robert Iger is? Robert Iger is the CEO of Disney. And we asked him, we were talking about this, and we asked him, what's the most important thing that you look for when you hire someone to work for you at Disney? Number one, he said, he looks for people who are intellectually curious. That makes sense. The biggest surprise in this list, to me at least, was the E word, empathy. Because I had a stereotypical view. I said, why do businesses have to be empathetic? Why do business people have to be empathetic? And yet, again and again and again, from Beijing to Boston to the Bay Area, the executives talked about empathy. And empathy means the ability to put yourself in the position of other people. To imagine yourself in their head, looking through their eyes, and really not just understanding them, but appreciating what they have to go through to get through life, both for people who are working with you and for you, and markets. If you're going to be marketing something, you need to kind of get in the heads of, you know, what is a 15-year-old female in Brazil, I mean, how does she think about the world, if you want to know what kind of media, for example, to produce for her. So empathy was important. Cultural competence is important. Why would cultural competence be important in today's world? Yes, ma'am.
I think because the world is increasingly global with so much ability to talk to anyone, anywhere, at any time. And I think there's going to be much more interaction between people in different countries.
Right.
And it's very important to be able to understand what their culture, what their cultural norms are and how to cater to that and how to
right.
be respectful.
It's essential. But there's another kind of cultural competence. If we define cultural competence as the ability to think, move, and act across borders, there are other kind of borders. Yes, sir.
So
tell me your name and what you did right before coming here.
My name is Nick, and I'm a progressive degree student, so I'm still an undergrad at USC over in SCA.
Okay.
Crit studies.
Okay, good.
And so the other form of cultural competence would be looking at business organizations and moving outside of a functional organizational structure, so that being able to be competent in other functions other than your own business function, which allows like cross-functional teams to develop and allows you to be a more productive employee and allows all the workers to work towards
right.
one unified goal. In
exactly.
way.
And so some of you have may have noticed that when you go to the finance department, they all act like finance geeks. And when you go to the IT department, anybody from the IT? You go to the IT department, they all act like IT geeks, right? And when you go to the marketing department, so in order to be successful in the whole organization, you have to be able to move across even those borders inside of organizations. And I know that's sort of what you're talking about right through here. So you could learn all this stuff, but unless you adapt your own behavior to what you have learned, you're useless. I mean, you could be really smart up here, but if you don't have the will, the energy to say, okay, I've learned this stuff, I need to change my behavior. I need to change my behavior because of what I've learned. Otherwise, it's useless knowledge. It's useless knowledge. The last one is 360-degree thinking. This is the toughest one, I think. And this is something, it's hard to learn in a classroom. You really almost have to go out into the world and experience it. You have to try and fail. Another part of the definition is creativity. And the part I like best is connecting the dots. So all of us can be in a room here. And I could show something up on the screen that would, some people, it would look like random dots and circles and squares. And somebody else would lean back and say, you know, that really looks like X. I mean, whatever it would be. Like the I Ching. So it could be you know, one of the expressions of the I Ching. What's the I Ching? Singing group? No. What's the I Ching? Anybody know what I Ching is? It is, now you've put me on the spot. It's a set of patterns that is sometimes used, I am told, in China to tell, not quite fortunes, but yeah, to sort of reveal the way the universe is going to be acting on you. I-C-H-I-N-G. Am I badly pronouncing it?
Oh,
now I talk about cultural incompetence. Okay, so first of all, let's get this straight. What's the correct way to pronounce it?
I-Ching.
That's what I said, I-Ching.
No,
no. I-Ching. Say it again.
It's like the Jack Jing.
Okay, so pronounce it again.
I-Ching.
I-Ching.
Yeah.
That's what I said, I-Ching. I-Ching. Okay. So what would a good definition of I-Ching, sir, what would it be? How would you describe I-Ching?
It's a matter you see, like for something in China, you just use that instead of a gram or something. I'm not sure whether it is.
So you're as bad as I am then, okay. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, it's a mysterious book about how the universe works.
Okay. Everybody hear that? It's a mysterious book for how the universe works. It's almost as good as Third Space Postcard. So that's a great example of cultural competence. I didn't know how to pronounce it. I didn't quite know what it was. But I'd like to think I was empathetic enough to want to know more about it. And I tried to adapt my really bad pronunciation so that I could try to do that. So that's sort of an example of a lot of these issues. So those are the individual parts. And I want to make one more point, which is that the importance of this approach, and by the way, this is something that the Annenberg School for Communication and Journalism is doing, and no other school in the United States of America that I've been able to tell is quite working on this effort. And we think it's really important because when we talk to people in other universities, in government, in the private sector, in NGOs, they say this is the magic sauce. This is the stuff that they are looking for and they can't find enough of it, and it's really valuable. And not only for businesses, but wouldn't you want your neighbors to be empathetic and culturally competent? If you were working at a neighborhood organization or a nonprofit, wouldn't you want these attributes to be available? And they're important not only, they're more important for the way they fit together as a whole. And that's the really, really important point as you think about organizations. Do you think everybody's going to have all these five? Probably not.
To some extent, everybody has at least a little bit of it.
Yeah.
Say not
right. I think that's that, and that's really important. I think the interesting discussions is how do they fit together? If you have intellectual curiosity, but you're not empathetic, you could just be a jerk. You know, like you could walk up and say, "Oh, I hear this about China. Tell me about it." You say, "Well, that's impolite." You have to be empathetic and understand how people are going to respond to your intellectual curiosity. It's also the case, as you just mentioned, is that everybody probably has some of this. But based on our brilliant assessment tool, by our brilliant professor over there, we can assess your strengths and weaknesses. Okay? But think about this as an alternative or a complement to thinking like a mathematician or thinking like a engineer or thinking like a traditional business person. Okay. So with that kind of background, are there any other kind of definitional questions before we move on a little bit? Yes, ma'am. Adaptability? Yeah, we sort of said if you learn all this stuff and you don't allow it to change your behavior or your view of the world, then why did you waste your time to learn stuff? It's like it goes in, it goes in, it goes in, it piles up, and then nothing happens in terms of your own relationship with the world. So that's sort of the... Any other questions about what all this stuff means? Yes.
Why wasn't resilience included on there?
That's a good question. I don't know. Why should we include resilience in it?
Because you're bound to have failure.
Mm-hmm.
And if you get completely derailed by it, I mean, how do you bounce back? I mean, the greatest successes come from failures. Look at Thomas Edison.
Right.
How many times did he fail with a light bulb? Yet he did not give up because he believed in it. And
right.
He knew he had that idea, and it was just a matter of finding a different way to go about it. I mean, I've come encounter with or come in contact with a lot of people that are not, that don't necessarily have the ability to be resilient. And it completely, I mean, in terms of working with the organization and supporting that overall mission and what that team is working to accomplish, it doesn't get accomplished.
Give me an example of, I mean, I think, by the way, resilience is a really important word that you read in Harvard Business Review and other places like that. Both resilience as an individual and resilience of a system to be able to bounce back. So is there an example that comes to mind of where someone could have done something differently, but they just were not resilient enough?
Yeah, I used to work for an engineering consulting firm.
Mm.
And our main purpose for the department I was in was to deliver requests for proposals to the clients. We were dealing with really big clients.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody was delegated different tasks for creating the RFP. And when one person would drop the ball on one thing, there were instances where someone would drop the ball and it would completely impact their ability to be on time and meet the deadline. And it became more of kind of like damage control and working with that person rather than getting the work done. So it completely shifts the focus from what it needs to be.
So resilience means sort of you're doing something and suddenly something pops up and you say, oh my goodness, this is a mess.
And I did it wrong.
And I did it right.
Yeah.
Well, some people say, oh, I did it wrong. I'm going to run as far away as quickly as possible.
And then people have to go after and they have to clean up your mess.
But the resilient person does what? What are they? Let me try something. What does a resilient person do?
I think they adapt to the failure. I think resilience, it kind of falls under adaptability where you're talking
Whether
you're talking about an individual or an organization.
Right.
Right. If using your own definition of applying what you've learned to your own behavior as an organization, you've learned your successes and your failures, and hopefully from that, you know.
Is there an example in your own life where, in retrospect, you say, gee, I wish I'd been more adaptable, or I'm proud of myself because something happened and I proved adaptable to it. Can you think of an example?
Work experience?
Yeah, or work or family, whatever.
Yeah, I mean, in a work experience, before this I had worked in for a guitar manufacturing company. And it was during like the rise of Amazon and online sales, and we were able to adapt strategies away from relying on music stores and having to deal with that whole line of thinking and manufacturing and distribution and saving money and being able to get on the trend of shifting things online and cutting out certain, you know, physical middlemen.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. It's a good example. Yes.
But I think Shelby's question does lead me to the question of where were these terms created? Who did the original research?
Yeah.
Why are we, as USC, kind of like very focused on third space?
Mm-hmm. Let me sort of answer. I think that you put your, what's your first name?
Jamie.
Let me have your names just so I can.
I'm Julia.
Okay, Julia. So the question that Shelby asked was, where's resilience? And resilience is, in the management literature, is a big deal right now, as I said, both for systems and for individuals. I think we put that under adaptability. It's not quite the same, but you know, we were trying to, and this is an important part for those of us who want to be communicators. Five is a good number. You can sort of remember five. Eight is harder to remember. Three feels too reductionist. And so as we kind of tested this back and forth, five seemed to work out. And so like 360 degree thinking also includes creativity, connecting the dots, et cetera, et cetera. So they're not perfect, but this is why I think it's important for us to think about it as an ensemble, as a portfolio, as a group of five things, and to engage in conversations like we've been engaging. Well, what does adaptability mean? What's the difference between adaptability and flexibility, for example? So the question was, how do we make all this mess up?
I'd love to know.
I can't tell you. I think it both makes it more mundane and more cool. But it really is the case. Okay, turn the camera. No, don't turn the camera off. Okay. So 4 or 5 years ago, I didn't know what the hell public relations was. I had bad stereotypical views of what public relations is. So I said, that's pretty crazy. I'm a dean of a school that's teaching public relations. But I'm ignorant about public relations. So I could have stopped, I don't want to I'm just sort of saying the journey. So me and my team could have stopped right there. We'll keep teaching public relations the way we've always taught it. We won't be adaptable. But I was sort of curious. Gee, I wonder. And I met some really smart public relations people, but I didn't know what they did. And they said, well, you know, public relations is merging with strategic communications and merging with marketing and advertising. So what I did was pick up the phone and call someone who was on my board of advisors, who was CEO at one of the public relations companies, Weber Shandwick. And I said, Harris, I'm really ignorant about public relations. You gotta help me. He said, okay, idiot. Well, he didn't say that, but there was this tone. He said, okay, Ernie, fly to New York and I will get in a room all of the top, the CEOs of all the top public relations companies in America. So there were like 6 or 7 of the CEOs there. And we sat for 3 hours and kicked it back and forth. And the question, same one I'm going to ask you, what's the most important attribute when you hire people? And when you promote them, what's the most important attribute? And then there was a question that was devastating, that really hurt me and embarrassed me. And I went screaming from the room. No, I didn't go screaming from the room. But the question was asked by a fellow who was the CEO of Hill & Knowlton, one of the largest public relations companies in the world. And he was like British, so he had that intimidating accent. And he had like this shirt that had collars and cuffs. I mean, he looked like $1 million. And he said, okay. He said, Dean Wilson, if I hire an economist, I know what I'm getting when I hire them. When I hire a physician for a project, I know what a physician does. And then he said, if I should hire one of your students, what premium will they bring to my organization? And I said, I said, let me get back to you on that. And so 3 years later, that happened. And one thing we want to use this for is that when you go to job interviews and someone asks you the question, why should I hire you rather than an MBA? Why should I hire you rather than someone who has a degree in psychology? What I hope you will be able to say now is, this is why you should hire me. Because MBAs don't have this to the same extent that comm management students do. this is why you should hire me, because engineers are woefully lacking in this. And if you hire me, I'll help you understand risks and opportunities better and make you more money, or help you serve more clients if you're an NGO. So that, I mean, that's, you know, the, and then the good news is that I then came back to the Annenberg School and started talking to my faculty, and their response was, it ain't that big a deal, we're doing this already. I wasn't expecting that response. So we've got to do this. Yeah, and if you look at our placement rates and the surveys we've done of our students, we have a lot of this already. So in some ways, this is making formal what we've been doing over the years, but extending it in different directions. And the good news is that as we go out to talk to venture capital firms or IBM, some of the stuff that maybe you saw on the website, people say, yep, this is right. Then the question is, what are you going to do about it? And so part of what we're trying to do is engage with our graduate students and give a course built around this to the undergrad, freshmen and sophomores. PhD students, not so much. But for undergraduates and MA students, we think this is a competitive advantage. I hope you will come back in 5 or 6 years, come back in 10 years, and then make a really big donation to the school. But even before you do that, come back and see the extent to which this is or is not engaged with the curriculum. It's an experiment. It might fail. Then I'm just stuck with a whole bunch of postcards. But if it succeeds, it's a big deal. So let me ask you then, which of these attributes do you think is the most important? What's been the most, for those of you who, for anyone in the room, before you got here, which of the attributes do you think has been most useful to you or important for you in your life and career? Yes, you just raised your hand. Oh, you were just fiddling with your, well, you just raised, your hand went above your shoulder, so you're busted. So tell us, in your experience, what has been the most helpful to you? Which of these five?
I would say 360 degree
thinking? Why would that be the case?
Because I feel like if you like have a bigger picture in your mind, like what's your position, what's your job in a whole organization, you sort of know that the direction of your position is to, so that you know how you can improve yourself. You cannot know, you know, that if I do this, I could do my job better. Right. Yeah, so like that's a way that you can keep on improving yourself.
Where were you before coming here?
You mean undergraduate school?
Yeah. What did you do before you flew out to?
I just graduated from undergraduate.
Okay. School. And what's your name?
Tianqi.
Yeah. Okay. How did you come to that conclusion? What was it in your life? What was it in your experience that led you? Because that's a wise statement.
At that time, my supervisor didn't tell me a lot more than just my job. He just told me, you know, you do this, you do that. And it took me, I would say, a couple of months to figure out, oh, so this is what my job is for. I was like an intern editor in a newspaper. So I would, then after a couple of months, I realized, okay, so this is what I should do. And this is my position in the whole like newspaper news production system.
Mm-hmm.
And then I know that if I, you know, if I come up with better ideas, I know like, I know it is a better idea. Because I know that, oh, this is the direction that I should.
That's a great point. Let me ask you, one of the things that has come up when we go talk to companies, the big question is, we're afraid of digital disruption, as they should be afraid of digital disruption. Another one is, we can't figure out these damn millennials. And so, is that kind of, and so one of the things that you hear about millennials is they really want to know how all this stuff fits together. Yeah. and they're a little reluctant. If you say, well, we want you to do this and just do this.
I want to know why.
You want to know why. I mean, is that, let me ask the rest of you, is that something that you feel is particular to your generation or not?
It could be for our generation because we didn't grow up with, like, probably parents working in the factory that every day they do the same work.
Mm.
And we can change our jobs basically every year if we
not. Did everybody hear that? Okay.
Should I talk a bit louder?
Maybe just a little bit. At least for me, if not for the people in the back row.
And also because we have more information and we learn faster. We absorb information faster than the previous generation with social media online. Mm-hmm. So we probably need to know a little bit more about.
That's an interesting point. You had your hand up, sir. And your name is?
Yuan Zhen.
Say it again.
Yuan Zhen.
Yuan Zhen? Close enough. Okay, thank you.
No, I wanted to add that for me the most important aspect is adaptability. Because for me it's a kind of empathy. And adaptability, like, for me includes curiosity and it brings competence. And then whenever you have competence, you're able to think and go through things. So, yeah, and whenever you can adapt to any kind of people, you've done 70% of the work.
So adaptability for you is something.
Yeah.
Vous êtes français, or where are you?
Yes.
De quelle partie de la France?
Paris.
De Paris même.
Oh, wow.
Quel arrondissement? I'm just showing off, that's all. I'm like one culturally competent guy.
Well, you see, that's what I'm talking about, adaptability. You have a nice French.
Merci bien. French accent. Vous êtes bien gentil de dire. Give this man an A.
Yeah, I'm from the, you know, Bois de Boulogne, 16, West Side.
Ah, très chic.
Yeah, I like it, it's too boring.
Okay. Okay, so we've had adaptability. We've had 360-degree thing. Was there some experience that you kind of lead you to, other than being French and coming to Southern California?
No, because I've had different kind of experiences that were where I was able to work with entry-level people and then executive, and then asking me to use my different kind of skills, different kind of languages, and so yeah, I feel like by working with different kind of people, you get a certain knowledge and a certain cultural ethics and education and competence, and which brings to yourself a bigger curiosity to become even bigger.
So for you, you sort of start with adaptability,
yeah,
like, and then you and from then you go out to the other. Okay, that's a good point. Yes, ma'am.
For me,
and your name is
Jackie.
And you're where'd you come before here?
From China.
Okay, China's a big country, though. You gotta work with me, Jackie.
I changed my job 5 times.
Good. Well, you're very millennial.
But actually, I'm not the typical millennial. My last job is working Mattel, the toy company.
Mm-hmm.
But through my career, I changed my job 5 times. I started in a state-owned company in China.
SOE.
That's very different culture. The biggest leader is the Chinese Communist Party leader. And then I went to Unilever, the typical British academic culture company. And then I went to L'Oreal, the cosmetics company. So the culture is very different. The industry is different. So for me, the most useful attributes is adaptability.
So you're what's your name, by the way?
Paul.
That's boring. I should say, you know, quelque chose, I mean, like 5 syllables. Okay. So Paul agrees with you. You agree with Paul that adaptability is really.
I hope I had other attributes stronger. For example, like 300-degree thinking, but it is adaptability helped me survive until today.
That's
surviving
interesting.
Different culture, different companies. And for adaptability, I want to emphasize that you need to adapt to the environment very quickly. It's not step by step, we jump directly in and make yourself understand the company, the culture, the business in a very fast speed.
Interesting. So that's, we've had adaptability, 360 degree thinking. Who has it?
Something to my name, for example, yeah. Like, no, just because it's funny, so you said, for example, Paul is boring as a name, but that's actually, I feel like maybe it comes from my parents, because they wanted me to get this name so then I could adapt myself.
Oh. Strategic parents.
I can go to Lebanon tomorrow, people know Paul. I can go to China, Paul, yeah.
So whereas if your so if your name was Henri Pierre le quatrième, then it would be more difficult to be culturally. So you had your hand up here, yes.
Yeah.
No,
I
just
think one of the attributes that's very important is empathy.
Empathy.
And, there are two aspects. First of all, I used to work with a huge team on a pitch. And there are 11 people on the team, and I'm kind of the team leader. And I saw, like, different people had their way to work and their own thoughts and their own personalities, and you have to stand by on their side to think why he did something that you may disagree with, but he or she has their own reason to do so, and that's a part of empathy. And another is because I an advertising major in undergraduate. And yes, just as you said, there are a lot of different market segmentations and different consumer segmentations, and it's kind of hard to really understand a people that different from you are thinking about. For example, we were doing a case for a children medical company, and we are trying to reach mothers, like young mothers. And yes, of course, I'm not a young mother, and so it's kind of hard for us to imagine how she considered when she wanted to buy something. So we did some research and survey on them, but still it's kind of, you know, not something you really have that experience, or really you can think of that experience, so it's still a little bit, have a little bit of distance with that.
That's a great point. So the people who are hiding in the back row, the third person in.
Long guy, yeah.
Yeah.
Frederick.
So Frederick.
I just wanted to ask about, is the correlation between the different factors, is it known? That, because I just thought, I agree with Paul what he said about adaptability, that everything comes from that. But for instance, to have this kind of adaptability and to be able to do it, I think you need to be highly intellectually curious. And but you don't need to have cultural competence in the beginning for that,
right?
Because you can grow it by adapting yourself and by asking questions.
Right.
So how about the correlations? Is it like, do you know about it already?
Yeah.
That's a great, we're going to have two answers here. The one answer is going to be a typical professor answer by answering with a question. Is there a hierarchy of these five attributes? Are some more important, or the term I use, foundational, than others? Secondly, are some of them innate and others learned? Someone here said, well, everybody's born with it. I think you mentioned that. Everybody has a little bit of the five, but can they be encouraged? So I think the great question that you're asking is, how do these things fit together? But we do have some empirical evidence, I think.
I might try to actually find that, but absolutely. You can see some of the connections between the concepts. But while you're talking, I'll see if I can actually show up the correlation.
Okay, that'd be great. But again, what I really want you to take away, folks, is not just the five, well, let me put it this way. I do want you to take away the five things, okay? And just think of it as a checklist. You go in for a job interview, or you're doing a job. You can say, well, have I approached it with empathy? Have I done it with cultural competence? Boom, 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 boom. The more successful of you, will figure out a way how to integrate these things into your unique approach to evaluate risks and opportunities. So one thing is just learn, I mean, that's the basic entry level. That's the Yugo car. I mean, it's like, you know, it's like the Cadillac Lexus version is where you are able to integrate those things in problem solving in your personal life or your civic life or your professional life. Okay? I'm trying to pick, okay, yeah. Tell me your name again.
Catherine,
okay.
I wanted to also echo the importance of empathy, because I think it's something that, it's a competency people think that they have, but they're not actually practicing empathy a lot of the time. There's a lot of listening, but not really hearing what people are saying, not actually putting yourselves in the position of somebody else. And so many of the problems in the world, whether it be global politics or even like interpersonal relationship problems, come from not fully understanding where the other person is coming from, but thinking often that you have that connection and saying, oh, no, I get it, it's because of this.
Right.
And it is something that I think in a lot of cases, you know, you can teach people how to better.
You say you can. Yeah. How would you do that? I mean, how would you,
in a setting
like this, or?
So I was a seventh grade teacher for a few years before coming here, and I actually was teaching a social studies curriculum that was really heavily based around, like we did a huge unit on the Holocaust and things like that. It was based around sort of turbulent points in history where there have been big clashes. We also did like Salem witch trials and things like that. And a lot of, which in no means, you know, I think that even like very experienced teachers who were dealing with that kind of material can't just say, oh, well, this is how you teach empathy. But it was really sort of baked into the curriculum of not just like, here's what happened, but like, let's look at, you know, how Weimar Germany came to be and how, you know, what people were thinking at the time. I think it is the kind of thing where, like, I don't know. I guess there's no easy answer.
So here's a question for you, Kat. Do you think that some of the seventh grade students that you were teaching, by the end of the school year, had become more empathetic? I mean, could you see evidence of that in their behavior or their language? Or?
Yeah, I do think so. I taught seventh grade girls. It was an all girls school, not like, you know, historically or whatever an age group that's particularly friendly with each other, and you know, we were generally able to get to a kind of place where it was I don't like this girl and she doesn't like me, and that's okay. I think I understand. Which is a huge victory
for
girls. So.
So here's an interesting question for you. As I read, if you look at the five attributes, do you think they skew male or skew female? Or are they equibalanced between the two genders?
I don't think any of these attributes are gendered.
Mm-hmm. Everybody agree with that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. They've done studies on like workplace empathy and things, and found generally that women leaders have it more frequently than men.
My suspicion is that if you look at that postcard, if you show it to 100 folks, empathy, adaptability, cultural competence. My own suspicion is it skews a little bit female. It skews a little bit female. I mean, empathy is not exactly what I think of when I think of guys, at least when I was growing up. Now, here's another question for you. And, you know, who the hell knows what the right answer is? I mean, we have to do a lot more research, which we don't have. But there is a fair amount of research that does suggest that certain attitudes and approaches are gendered. You know, without saying it's good or bad, but it's another hypothesis that I have as an African American male is that if you grow up at the bottom of society, on the outskirts of society, then that may also racialize the attributes. So when I was growing up in Washington, D.C., which was at that point a segregated southern town, which means that my family could not go to certain stores or certain restaurants because we were black Americans. So it was segregated. So when I was growing up, my father would say to me, look, you have to be, he didn't say culturally competent, but he said, you have to know how white folks behave, even though you don't grow up around them, and you have to know how African Americans behave. You have to be adaptable, because if you're not adaptable, you might be stopped by the police and thrown in the back of a police car, and bad things might happen. So this raises some interesting cultural and structural questions as to whether or not these attributes are gendered. Are they associated with your position in the social hierarchy or not? And I think at this point it's still, the evidence is not clear. I have my own, you know, interpretation and perception of it, but it's just something to keep in mind as you work through organizations, work in organizations, as you try to be empathetic and culturally competent, that one of the attributes might be that these things are somehow affected by parents. Someone talked about their parents. It may be affected by your community, et cetera. So you found the, is there a correlation?
Oh, yes. High correlation, actually.
Is this us or the?
This is these people.
Okay, so you all are guilty of this, you know. So
you all were taught how to understand a correlation in Comm Management 540. These are high correlations. And so what we're seeing is there does seem to be overlap. They're not necessarily the same thing, but you know, I can't help but feel very similarly to what Paul was expressing earlier. And this is just a personal take on this, not trying to put a new spin on it, but I see adaptability as an outcome of interest for me, personally. And then I see some of the other factors as contributing to my ability to be adaptive. Or in other words, there might be some attributes, if I lack them, would limit my ability to adapt. If I don't have cultural competence, I may not be able to adapt in certain situations. If I lack 360-degree thinking, by the way, our phrase in this class, when we've been talking about 360-degree thinking, is systems thinking. We've been talking about that, right? If I don't have 360-degree thinking, I'm going to have a hard time adapting. Empathy, we've brought this up many times in this class. Both cognitive empathy, where we are able to engage in perspective taking, as well as sort of more traditional empathy in terms of thinking about understanding how others feel. So we can be persuasive in the sense that we can appeal to both heart and head, right? So if we have empathy, if we have cultural competence, if we have 360-degree thinking, that really helps us be more adaptive in a variety of situations. Intellectual curiosity, to me, is incredibly important for adaptability, because if we are going to, adaptability to me means change, the ability to change. You have to be curious about change and embrace it and find that interesting rather than, oh my goodness, fearful of change. But on the other hand, to me, intellectual curiosity is kind of like the straw that stirs the drink, right? I mean, you can be culturally competent because you've had a lot of international experiences or different work experiences, and you've been exposed to different boundaries, but not everybody is intellectually curious enough to really pay attention to the nuances. Likewise with 360-degree thinking. Likewise with empathy and perspective taking. So to me, if you ask me which one is most important, it's like, well, they're all important and they're all related, but the Brad Shipley sort of emphasis is on how can I be more adaptive, and what do I need to be adaptive? I need these three but really intellectual curiosity is what we've been talking about, perhaps kind of that implicit motivation, right? To really be curious about a lot of things in terms of our thinking, perspective taking. Danielle is going to lead us in a discussion here in a couple of weeks on cultural competence, right? So, I mean, we've had a lot of opportunities in this course to really think about a number of these issues, but are they related? Is there a correlation? Yeah. Now, I don't know if we put this in a model, we haven't.
I think that one thing that's interesting to think about too is that it definitely will vary depending on how on where these are positioned. So as far as curriculum goes, right, depending on, and this is something that Brad and I are doing with the curriculum review we brought to your attention last week. One thing that we're doing is looking at the way in which each individual course has mapped these out in terms of readings, in terms of assignments. And so implicit in that is the assumption that you're going to learn and you're going to exercise these kinds of skills. But when you're looking at it from the point of view of whether you are, for instance, an INFP or an ENFP or, you know, whichever other, there's four, right? Right, as an INFP, absolutely, right, for me, 360 thinking is the starting point. And in part because I work within an environment, right, that is, or at least in an industry, communication, that is so multidisciplinary, where it's important to really identify who you are in relationship to everything else that you touch as a field. So I guess my point is, I think these correlations, it's interesting to look at them. It's important for you to think about how you're going to use them in terms of presenting yourself, in terms of identifying, as far as a professional identity, what it is that drives you, how it is that you want to speak to someone, why it is that you're interested in particular things. And then as far as classroom goes, you know, the classes that you choose, the skills that you decide to learn more about, a lot of this is driven by these five values, for sure. But are there more? You can fit them all under these, resilience being one of them.
Mm-hmm.
Real quickly about gender, if I may, since we were raising the question of whether some of these are gendered, we know, right? Today's Equal Pay Day. Are we aware of that?
Oh, no.
Today's Equal Pay Day. We don't have equal pay, right? Quite yet. And this is something that the Obama administration has been bringing to our attention, which is interesting and good. As far as workspace goes and workplace, there's a lot of research that shows, for instance, as far as empathy goes, that women are the strongest negotiators on behalf of others, not themselves. Right? So in many ways, every one of us comes into the workplace or life the moment you walk into a door. Your gender, your race, your sexuality, all these identity politics absolutely define how you then embrace these, how you represent them, how you perceive them, how you think of them, how you exercise them. So I would say all of these absolutely have a gendered, racial, sexual, age dimension,
mm-hmm.
for sure. And we'll talk more about this in 2 weeks, just to give you a preview.
That's fascinating. So what would you say the empathy 360 degree correlation is the highest one on the screen? What does that tell us about the potential foundational aspects, or what would you say about that correlation?
Yeah, I mean, that's incredibly interesting to me. I don't think that 360 degree thinking necessarily leads to higher empathy or the reverse. It seems to be, given our data, if this is a representative sample of the larger population, that's debatable. It seems to be that people who are high in empathy also are high in 360 degree thinking. I do think that underlying 360 degree thinking is this sense of looking at things from multiple perspectives.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not entirely shocking to me that people who are looking for patterns and different ways of viewing the same set of data might also be very good at perspective taking in terms of how people are thinking and feeling.
That's fascinating.
Yeah. Is this sample our four classes that we're looking at correlations with?
So this is 100 and some students?
150
students.
It'd also be interesting to see how maybe age would take into account some of these.
Yeah, we also, and I have not entered this data, but remember one of the weeks I said, hey, your quiz question for the week is, tell me whether or not you're a native English speaker. Remember that? So that's something that we're looking at. We can definitely tease this out in a number of directions, but we are very much in the early stages of research on this. But there are some really interesting connections. Nick?
I think what's interesting with empathy is that in addition to having the highest correlation there with 360-degree thinking, it also has the lowest of all of them with cultural competence.
I know.
And that's what's surprising to me.
Yep.
Because in my perspective of empathy, and also how it aligns with 360-degree thinking,
yeah,
is the ability to like take things from multiple perspectives and use that in a productive way.
Yeah.
So you'd think that would also extend to cultural competence in that part of being empathetic and using multiple perspectives is doing that in an intercultural way, be it by nationality cultures or also departmental cultures, and you'd want to see it from that perspective too. So it's surprising that would be such a low correlation.
I absolutely agree. In fact, that caught my attention as well, and it makes me want to go back and look at the assessment. And my initial theory, if you will, is, I mean, we took these scales. We didn't just like make up a bunch of stuff. We took the scales from existing studies that have reliability and validity studies. But a lot of the studies on empathy deal with interpersonal. And so our empathy scale is not necessarily dealing with cultural differences. But I think if you are high on, if you're high on cultural competence as measured here, and high on empathy, you probably do have something really valuable in that combination.
Yeah.
But do I think that the two are related? I do, and that still is a high correlation.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that the way that we have operationally defined,
mm-hmm,
in terms of here we're asking this set of questions, maybe isn't picking up on a sense of intercultural empathy.
Yeah. First of all, I think going off that, it's interesting to note that cultural competence is the lowest one overall for such an international group of students. In general, it's only didn't break the 70s here, even though there's still high correlation. The other thing I wanted to go back, I think, to the conversation about adaptability and empathy. And I think that for me personally, like, similarly, adaptability is probably one of the things that's gotten me the most to where I am, but it's been influencing me more than empathy, because I think you need empathy in order to inform all of the other ones, in order to, like you said, inform intellectual curiosity so you're not going to be a jerk about it, in order to inform your 360-degree thinking. Like, it's implicit in that you need to be able to look 360 degrees, and what do you need for that? Like a high emotional intelligence, a high level empathy,
yeah,
to put yourself in other people's shoes, to know what to adapt and how to adapt. Like, if you just have the desire to be adaptable, that does nothing unless
right.
you know what to adapt, how to do that, and to learn to do that. I think you need to be able to see yourself from other people's perspectives. I mean, we live in the age of like Fitbit and like self-quantification, but I think it's
yeah.
important also to look at, instead of objective, also other people's subjective views of yourself and your organization, if you're thinking larger as well.
Yeah.
Maybe take a couple more questions, and I have one final question I want to ask you. I don't know, you haven't, there's a question back here.
You.
I totally agree with you. And just one of the best role models, a boss I had who was amazing, who started out as an assistant 16 years ago and went everywhere from casting to current series to development, always shifting higher and higher without necessarily having the background. I think she did it because she was such an empathetic person, and she understood the people that she led and could inherently adapt and figure out the skills she needed, but mostly was just a really good leader because she got what motivated the people that she led. And that's been super inspiring and a great model for me to see that skill can take you so far.
Yeah, I mean, if you look at the research that we we read on transformational leaders. I mean, it was like a laundry list of this stuff. Different terminology and different points of emphasis, but a lot of overlap there.
Let me build off of that off that question, and ask the class, especially those of you who haven't spoken yet, how useful do you think this approach is really going to be? And please be honest. I'm not grading you. This is just, you know, and we're still early in this whole process. So, yes, sir.
I think it's very useful. I think it's very hard to teach. Like, I think all these attributes or skills you have to acquire in real life, going out in the world and do something, whatever, working, traveling, whatever, but not in the classroom. That's just, like, it's good to know, and you can be aware of all these attributes when you're going somewhere abroad or something. But actually learning it in a classroom or acquiring these skills in a classroom, I think it's hard.
Okay.
Angelica, I'm with my name. I think it's interesting because I have seen these come into play even before you guys have mentioned it here in class. For example, for me, adaptability has also been the strongest asset of all of these. I do think they're interrelated, but I also have learned them elsewhere too, which is why every time I go to a job interview or something like that, I do say that's my strongest asset is being adaptable. I've had, you know, a couple jobs, and I think I've been able to excel in each and every one of them, even though they've been in different areas, because of that reason and all the experiences that have come with it. So I do agree with Fred in thinking that it is something that you learn with experiences. Might be in the classroom, but I don't know specifically in what area.
Yes, ma'am.
Another question I've had, though, is the scores kind of just seem to be in the air right now. So like, I'm kind of curious, what does each score mean specifically? So if you get a 3 out of 4, what is that, you know, what does that tell me? And then based on that, how do I improve? You know, is the object to get 4 out of 4 in all of them? Is it possible to get 4 out of 4?
Great.
So kind of like, you know, kind of grounding it more in like what exactly this sort of means and then how I can learn about it.
Let me give you the easy part, and then Brad can give you the hard part. The easy part, and this was really Rebecca's pressure. Rebecca said, hey, you need an assessment tool. And I said, boring, I don't want to do assessment tools, blah, 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 assessment. And then she convinced me, and in working with the companies, convinced us and convinced me it was important to do. What we tell the companies now is that what we use these for, when we go into a company and evaluate the group, is that it will tell us in advance of designing the course what we can or what the population looks like. So if everybody's high on empathy and low on adaptability, then when we go in and talk to them and try to develop some of these skills, then we know what we're working with. Do we strengthen the empathy part because they're really, or do we go for the other? That's a strategic or tactical question. What I was hoping for, but I was convinced by Brad and the experts, I was saying, great, so we'll go into a company, we'll go into an organization, we'll go blah, 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 third space, we'll do the test first, right? And then we'll teach them, and then we'll give them the test afterwards. And of course, what was I looking for? What was I looking for under those circumstances? Improvement, right? And what the experts are telling me is there is so much else going on in life that to say that there was a bump in a score is almost meaningless in that short amount of time. But maybe over a longer period of time, a year, you might be able to see something that would be plausible. So I think it shows the, and when I go marketing, that my other parts of my team don't like me to say this. because it seems like you should be able to go in, you're this way, you, somebody comes in from Annenberg, we're really brilliant and convincing, and then you go away, and then your life is changed forever. Doesn't seem, we're adaptable human beings, but I don't think we're that. But Brad, you've...
Yeah, I totally agree with that. So, and Fred, what you said earlier was exactly right. We can't teach these attributes like you can teach a math formula, right? That's not something that can be taught, but we can raise awareness, we can nurture it, we can model it, we can try to reinforce it, and it's really up to the individuals to take it from here forward. And if it's on your mind, then you're allowed to continue through that self-reflection process. The other thing that we have been toying with a little bit is the idea that when we go into an organization is to include a 360 degree evaluation, so that it's one thing to have your individual assessment, but it might not be entirely how you're perceived by others. And so we might not be getting a full picture of where we stand, or at least how we're coming across. In terms of what your scores mean, Camille, we gave you like a 1, 2, 3, or a 4. Those are actually not actually the raw scores. Those are relative scores. The real scores would be on a scale of 0 to 7, because it was a 7-point scale. And so a 1 meant below average relative to this population. A 2 was like low average, or average but lower. And then 3 was average but higher. And then 4 meant, you know, well above the average. Now, that's accurate to the extent that we were honest. Right. I mean, so I think because I saw some people with ones all the way across, and I think maybe they're just extremely humble people in terms of how they evaluated themselves. But I think for us individually, it's not so much the raw score. By the way, if we gave you the raw scores, we wouldn't see much differentiation. There wouldn't be a 1, 2, 3, and 4. We'd see it lumped up well above the midpoint. In other words, even if you have a 1, you're probably have, as someone said earlier, we all have some this to some degree. And so even if you're a 1, you're probably, and if you're here and part of this population, you probably have quite a bit of each attribute. The question for you individually to take away is just, how am I doing on this? You know, which areas should I really focus on? And if we walk away with that, then we continue to learn through our experiences, right? And then we can build on it. Yeah.
So actually, when I was doing the pass off fight, the 360 ranking, very tricky, because like I got 4.5 out of 4. So it's like when I was doing the test, I thought like maybe I'm really good at it because I tend to listen to opinions from different people from all perspectives. But meanwhile, I feel like sometimes I'm easy to get very confused because like people would take like very, I don't know, like opposite opinions from me. Because for instance, when I'm doing this internship, my colleague would told me that I really like you because you're really ambitious. My colleague told me, I don't like this part of you because sometimes I think you're like a little bit aggressive. So it's like, so I think I'm the person that tends to listen to people. So when people talk to me about this, I tend to change. So when the other people talk to me about something else, I tend to change. So it's like, I think like, I don't have a very clear self-assessment. So maybe like 360 degree thinking is different from 360 degree feedback, so I'm not so sure.
That's what I'm talking about. 360 degree feedback is different than 360 degree thinking, absolutely. But having 360 degree feedback would help us get a sense of how others perceive us. And by the way, when you had let's say a 3.23, that wasn't actually more than 3, less than 4. What it was is some of the scales have subscales. So it was a 3 on the main scale with a 2 on this subscale and a 3 on this subscale. we didn't get that detailed. We just gave you a paragraph in terms of what that meant. So a 4.44, for example, meant four on the main scale, four on this subscale, four on this subscale. It wasn't like, whoa, you're off the charts. It was four on all three.
Are there, what's missing from this discussion? Not necessarily what's missing from the attributes, although that could be part of it. Yeah. But are there some issues that we just haven't engaged with yet?
It's kind of,
yes,
kind of just a what's next. Like, we kind of like see this stuff and yeah, it's kind of nice to know, but like what do we really do with this? Where is it going? I see it maybe being something that happens down the line at Annenberg, but maybe for us, I'm still unsure. Mm.
And then maybe take one the question here too, and we'll answer both at the same time.
Just a thought that's been going through my head for like the last 30 minutes is emotional intelligence.
Yeah.
I feel like empathy is pretty one-dimensional, but there's so much that's encompassed in emotional intelligence that includes empathy, and there's sympathy, and there's ability to understand body language, and what, like, when do you give, when do you, you know, take a little bit, how do you approach different types of people, which also yields into cultural competence. I mean, it kind of one begets the other, and so, I mean, that's one thing I would personally change, but.
Yeah. Well, I think one of the things that, I think the takeaway could be, was it Aristotle or someone, one of the Greeks, who said, know thyself. And so, with any of these kind of assessments, it just adds to your existing store of knowledge about yourself. And so we gave one of these tests to one of the companies, and they were surprisingly low in empathy across the board. And one person was particularly low in empathy, which the other five members of the team laughed when they found that out, because they said, oh, she really is low in empathy. So I think, as Brad was saying, what this is an invitation to take this with you on your own journey and maybe think of it as I don't know, maybe what's the a map or as a checklist or something like that. And if you can look at the values across these five things, and one response is, I'm doing pretty well on all of them. Maybe we haven't tried to measure leadership, but my hunch is that people who eventually become leaders may have a particular pattern across these attributes. I don't know what they would be, but that might be the case. But I think it's like any other piece of knowledge. Take it and do something with it. Improve. Hire people who are your complement. On a team, work with people who are your complement. You don't want to have a team of all empaths. You know, you don't want to have a team of people who are just adaptable, because they'll give away the store and may not hold the core values. So I think that's sort of what I would.
Yeah, it's a way of personal assessment. It's a way of charting your own areas of development. This is not comprehensive. I like emotional intelligence. There are measures out for that. It's great. I like Myers-Briggs. We used it in this class. I think that's helpful information. But when Dean Wilson went and talked to executives, this is what they told him. So this is in demand. I mean, who knows?
Yeah.
As things change, a decade from now, we might have a different list. I mean, who knows? But right now, this seems to be in demand, and so we should definitely be taking a look at these and probably several other things. I mean, on a personal note, I like critical thinking. And by the way, we threw in a critical thinking test, and it's highly related. I would argue that many of these attributes help a person be a critical thinker. You have to look at it from different perspectives. You have to use
360 degree thinking to be an effective critical thinker. So, I mean, that's a different concept. It's worth measuring. We can't measure everything, but here are five in demand we should take a look at.
The other thing is that we've thought about this as a, which gets to the other question, as a think of it as a pyramid. This is not a good metaphor, but there are certain skills everybody needs to know. And they've always needed to have these attributes. Critical thinking,
yeah.
A certain energy, leadership skills. So if you go back to Roman times or, you know, other cultures, everyone needs this kind of base of the pyramid. But it just so happens in this particular historical era in which we are living, that is global, fast-moving, bringing multiple groups together, it seems to us that right above that basic level, these are five attributes that work for the historical period in which you are living. And then on top of that, on top of the pyramid, are other skills that might be specific to being a journalist or an advertising person or a military general or a politician or a physician. So if you think of it as sort of three layers, very basic, everybody needs this stuff, very specialized, you know, hand-eye coordination for a surgeon, for example. Those are valid, can't take them away. This middle thing is that. And the middle thing, we are told, are the attributes that lead to success in certain, in many sectors of one national economy. Let me just, one more question. How relevant is this stuff? I mean, this could be critiqued by saying, okay, who made this thing up? A bunch of Americans living in Los Angeles at a particular point in time. So why the hell should that have any relevance to somebody from France or Thailand or Nigeria? So maybe we could just reflect on that. I mean, there are a lot of students, since everybody knew what that tough word to pronounce, I Ching, that one. So how relevant would this be for China? I mean, are there things that we should reinterpret, try again, add to it? Going once, going twice, you've got the floor.
I just wanted to, I think it kind of goes back to what you said originally about it being sort of a map or a framework for things. You know, like Dr. Shipley said, we've been reading a lot about these types of assessments internationally and locally. You know, last semester in our branding and marketing class, we did a lot of international, looking at things internationally as well. And there are a lot of things I think that cross over. And when you apply these on a really, really small scale, cultural competence could be like person to person, department to department, organization to organization. And I think even if you're working for, you know, some examples are like L'Oreal and Unilever or the Communist Party of China, department to department competency, department to department curiosity, adapting from one stage to the next. I think those, when you're talking person to person, small picture, they work, I think, just as well. And they're like any other framework you use to interact with other people.
Well, let me give you two examples. So we, as I said, we had 25 or 30 senior Chinese officials. And three takeaways. One, the third space model is generally applicable in China. Generally. Secondly, when I asked the same question to the Chinese audience, they said, well, yeah, but let me give you some examples. So one guy stood up and recited from memory a poem that apparently is a famous Chinese poem that talks about empathy. And so the other folks in the room, the men and women, say, oh yeah, that's a good poem. And then, by the way, there are five in Analects, and you know, Confucius talked about this attribute, this attribute, this attribute. So at a second level, maybe it is particular cultural manifestations in Nigeria or China that could illustrate. But then there was a third thing that happened. And I don't know where this fits in, I really don't. But the discussion did not go very well for the first half of the first day in China. People didn't say very much. Their responses were kind of flat. And then what seemed to happen is that the senior-most person or couple of people started to talk about it. And then when they described the parameters, then the conversation flourished. What do I know? I'm not an expert in Chinese culture. But the way I interpreted it is that the rather top-down Confucius culture was saying it is permissible to talk about these issues once the most senior person in the group gives, either call it permission or indication or... So I'm just throwing that out there. And I know other countries better than I know China. And I can see certain similar dynamics there that have to do with authority, that have to do with individuality, that had to do with group and individual. I mean, it's, so I'm puzzled, not puzzled, but I'm intellectually curious and prepared to be adaptable. But I need some help here, folks. Don't leave me hanging. Yes, wait, no, did you have your hand up? Okay.
So for this, as you said, for like the senior explain the attributes, and later junior talks about this, but I think this top-down culture that senior may set a basic direction for the people to discuss, and later then the junior know what we should talk about based on their opinions about this topic. So it's kind of like that. Maybe that's the reason why they don't want to show like their thoughts, although they have their own thoughts.
Right.
Yeah. So the senior may like set a basic like type or like trend for the discussion, so then the juniors know what they think about, or what they think about this topic.
Right.
Yeah.
So that, you're going to make a point too.
Yeah. I just want to say like it's definitely about Chinese culture that we say 中庸, like stay in the middle.
Say that again.
中庸. Yeah, it's kind of like don't be
be humble.
Be humble, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's a Japanese expression too that, you know, sort of, yeah, it's probably not just restricted to China, but there is this idea of the, you know, you don't stick your head up before you might get nailed. Was it something about the nail and you don't get too far up, you get hammered down otherwise? So here's the question for you. Does that change the applicability of the model, or does it just mean that in its, when you try to do it, you have to be aware of things like authority, individuality, religion? Any thoughts on trying to get with me someone from the neighborhood? Who haven't I bothered? Everybody's looking down. Someone in the back row, who haven't I bothered yet? Gentleman here who's been paying close attention to the screen for much of this. What are your thoughts on this? So the question is, we say there are these five attributes, and we've come up to a discussion about the way those things are discussed in different settings. And does that mean that the five attributes are inadequate? Or does it mean we have to be culturally competent when we hear the conversation about them? I'm probably not being very clear on this because I'm not very clear on this.
No, I think it really does depend on the cultural context. I think it, because like as you were saying, there's different expressions in different cultures for, you know, how things should be done or what people's thoughts are. So I think it really depends on kind of taking those five attributes and fitting them into the culture in the way that best fits what's going on.
That sounds that sounds reasonable to me. I mean, I see heads nodding, so I take that as kind of a mini consensus of.
I was just going to say, I think that they do apply because of their cross-cultural values. Like, you just have to be very aware of how the norms would change, and so how, like, you know, so maybe in America, you know, certain, on the Likert scale, you get like certain averages, and then the averages would most certainly change when you go to different
cultures.
That's
a good point. So maybe these things that Brad was showing us will vary from Hong Kong to Chongqing or to Chicago. Well, I want to thank all of you for being responsive and open. I mean, this has been very helpful. We're still trying to figure this out. You know, a year from now, we say, oh, we tried this, it didn't work, we'll throw it away. But so what? It's an experiment. And one of the things that we're learning in this kind of crazy world that we live in is we have to experiment. We have to try stuff. Sometimes it'll work. Sometimes it'll fail. I hope this one doesn't fail. It'd be really embarrassing if it fails. But, you know, we'll see what the world... You're going to have the final word.
Okay.
Yes.
Well, I believe that third space is a great tool for increasing awareness and showing us attributes that are very admirable for potential employers and organizations. However, I just want to know, kind of, we discussed a lot of different components within this, but we really want to know, like, what now? Like, how can we use this so that we can frame to potential employers in an appealing way? Like, look, this is what I got here, and this is how I can use it to increase my chances of getting employed, or also include this in my resume somehow, or in a cover letter, or in a job interview. How can I frame this in a way to show them, like, I'm unique, I'm different, and also in a way, like, for instance, with our scores, maybe we don't like the scores we got, maybe we got higher on some and different, and someone mentioned a great question about how do we increase this, the scores, and how do we, because like I don't want to go to a job employer and be like, hey, I got 1 out of 4 or something on so-and-so and you should hire me. So just kind of like, how do we frame this and use this activity to learn and be
okay.
more appealing?
Two ways, individual and institutional. By the way, there's a really, really good annotated critical bibliography on all five of these attributes. And they look at the literature that looks just at individuals. And I think Ali did this one.
Yeah, we sent out the white paper.
Not my white paper.
Oh.
The one that Ali did?
The one that Ali did work. It's amazing.
Yeah.
Now, our mutual friend Patty doesn't want to release it because it's not...
Okay, maybe.
But I think it should be released. I mean, it's really... So, two responses. One is... The altruistic one is, as you think about going into a job interview, write out a script that you will say when you go into the job interview based upon the company that you're going to be talking to. So you go in, you analyze the company, you analyze the positions around the position that you're being interviewed for, and you just prep for it, just like you would prep for any test. The other thing that I would toss out, it would be helpful maybe to all of us if you guys figure that out. In other words, a group of adaptable, culturally competent ambitious, contributory, collegial people would say, why don't we call a group together of anybody who wants to come and talk about that question? I mean, I don't have an answer. I mean, you can see because I'm like faking it, right? So I don't have a sharp answer to that. But it would be interesting. I mean, I'd be willing to come back and let's say if you and five people say, okay, we go into a job interview, how do we use this really concretely to get a better job or to get that job? And then you work it out and say, well, we do this, we thought about that, that's not so good. And we got 2 pages of how to get, now there's a guy named Tom Friedman who is probably the most famous writer for the New York Times on global stuff. He wrote a column a year ago that said, how to get a job at Google. It was a series of 2 articles. You know what he said? You want to get a job at Google, and by extension other places, learn some hard skills and learn some soft skills. These are the soft skills. So if you want to get a job, you need to learn some of this, and then something like math or science or engineer, a little bit of engineering. So that's one of the tricks of the trade, to have that basket of skills. But other than that, this is still the front end. And you know, I can't guarantee that saying this is going to get anybody a job.
Can I say one thing, though?
Sure.
Yeah. So remember I think it was Dr. Weintraub that talked about this. And we talked about how it's not that useful to say I'm passionate, either you know, in an elevator speech or somewhere on your cover letter. Instead, what you want to do is demonstrate your passion, right? The same is true for these attributes. If you read through, you're not going to put on your resume, this is what I scored on the third space. Right. No, absolutely not.
Nobody will have ever heard of it, first of all. And they won't know the damn difference between a 5 and a 1.
They might think a 1 is great, who knows? But instead, what you want to do is look at the accomplishments that you have featured on your resume and the things that you have discussed in your cover letter and ask yourself, does this seem to be the profile of someone who has demonstrated 360-degree thinking, cultural competence, empathy? In my interview, when I've had these practice informational interviews, how am I coming across? Can I carry on a conversation and show how adaptable I am in that environment? So that's art more than science. It's not a recipe where we can say, now take this, this is what you do on your resume. It's you have to work with what you have, your experiences that you can put on the resume, but make sure that we are thinking about these things so that implicitly that message is coming across that I have these attributes to offer.
That's a great point. And the other thing is, let me give you some advice from an old guy. I don't want to hire people who are worried about their resume. And the higher up you go, people don't care about your resume. And you shouldn't care to, I'm going to say this really strongly. You should not care about your bloody resume. You should care about your career and what you are passionate about and how you want to change the world and what you bring to changing the world. Nobody gives a shit about your resume. It's a really bad mistake to think in terms of resumes. Think of terms of what kind of human being you are. Are you a caring human being? Are you passionate about something? And does that passion show through? And so, other than the 5 attributes, what I really, and this is not an attack, it's just my offering to you about what I have seen as somebody who I want someone who's going to come in and be energetic. And they say, you know, in 10 years, I want to do this. And their focus is on 10 years out, 15 years out. Because, you know, we all know what our most of us probably had a first job that's completely irrelevant to our second, third, fourth, fifth. The sister over here talked about having five jobs or something like that. So what is your fifth engagement? Let's not even call it a job. What is your fifth engagement going to be? Whether it's at a museum, or at the White House, or working for a VC, or teaching in a class. And that's what I would really counsel you. Use these things instrumentally, or however you will use them, but please, please, please think about your long-term future. Because anybody can hire anybody for the first job. How uninteresting is that? Because your first job is going to be probably crappy, right? I mean, you're not, you know, the CEO is not going to come down and say, well, now that you've joined me as a deputy assistant first year employee, let me explain the value of, they're not going to say that. But what will count is your passion for what you want to do with your life and what kind of contributions you want to make. That's the thing to focus on. And the first job, second job, third job is just a way station to becoming the kind of person that you really want to be.
Thank you. I think we should all give Dean Wilson a round of applause.
Great question.